two older brothers kept their pick. My brother Charlie played the guitar, Birch played the fiddle, and by the time I got to Bill, he had the mandolin, which at the time was pretty much a non-entity in folk music. But he was a strong man, he was ambitious, and he loved to play. He began to play with his brother and sing duets successfully. They did some recordings, and as his career progressed, he finally made it to the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville. In 1936, he auditioned and became a member of the opera. He was there all his life. In 1945, in December of 1945, the Bluegrass World kind of shifted. A couple of the members of his band had left, and he recruited two men to come in and play. One was Lester Flatt, a smooth singing guitar player, and the other was a banjo with his Earl Scruggs. The band consisted of Bill Monroe, Flatt and Scruggs, Howard Watson, Chubby Watts on fiddle, became the model bluegrass band. That was the sound that Bill was looking for. Now, bluegrass band, as you can see, there are no electric instruments in the band. They're all acoustic, and pretty much this is the lineup that has existed in the middle 40s. Mandolin, bass, guitar, banjo, well, not a fiddle players, but usually there would be a fiddle player. And when that band hit the stage in 1945, the place went wild. Bill Dewey had something. And for the next 50 years, he played with that configuration. Bill died in 1996, but he left a long legacy that has spread worldwide. And if you see a bluegrass band in Germany or Japan or in South America, you'll see something that's pretty much the same configuration as we have now. No electric instruments, no drums, acoustic instruments and voices. Enough talk. We'll get down to some music here. We'll do one for you that was made popular by a Bluegrass Hall of Fame member and South Carolina native Don Reno. This is called Welcome Home. Anything to be heard on the radio or 50s instruments here. And one of the very strong influences